5 years and still talking, this is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Well, as the sign says, this is the Ramble, and I'm Alex Bennett, and we'll be here until midnight tonight, Eastern Daylight Time.
GabNet's
ladies and gentlemen, out to California we go, out to the city so nice they had to quarantine it or do whatever they did. San Francisco, California, and Larry Bubbles Brown. Hello, Larry.
Yes, I'm not on lockdown yet.
But you're kind of, you. When I picked up the phone, we first started talking, you sound very depressed.
Yeah, I'm afraid they're going to put us so we're not allowed out of the house, which would be a nightmare. Mm-hmm. And I guess you're going through that too in New York.
Yeah, well, I haven't left the house, but then again, you know, I have 2,500 square feet here.
See, if I had a place like that, it wouldn't be so bad, but I've got this little studio, so I wouldn't do well in prison.
It's kind of like being in a prison cell when they say you can't leave. I can't. Now, what is the story in San Francisco? Because they say shelter in place, and our governor here in New York today was talking about shelter in place, and he said it doesn't say much. It was something that was originally meant for something else completely, like nuclear disaster or something like that.
Yeah. Out here, shelter in place means they encourage you to stay inside. They've shut down the restaurants, nightclubs. Those are all shut down. Yeah. You're allowed to go out, but you're supposed to stay 6 feet from anyone, and I guess that's it. And they said you're not supposed to take any unnecessary trips or anything unless it's essential.
So. Yeah, yeah. Here in New York, we don't have any restaurants, theaters, gyms are all closed.
Yeah.
Just about everything is closed. The restaurants are allowed to offer takeout.
Takeout, right. So you sound like you're in the same situation we are.
Yeah. But a lot of restaurants are saying they can't subsist on takeouts alone, you know. And a lot of them are going to be forced to close down if this goes too long, you know.
Yeah,
and go out of business, literally.
Huge depression.
Huh?
I think it's not going to be a recession. It's going to be a depression the way things are going out of business.
Think of how many people are out of work.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing. And, of course, I'm sure in the wonderful world of comedy, forget it, you don't have any gigs, right?
No. Totally screwed.
Yeah. Have people called you up and canceled gigs?
I had one canceled last week, yeah.
Yeah, wow. And there are no clubs. Of course, there are no nightclubs open, so that they can't do comedy.
Yeah, you can't do anything.
Yeah. So you would be totally out of work.
Yeah.
Maybe Durst is lucky to have had that stroke. You know? I mean, it's a time of just not working. It's really a terrible, terrible time for us. And how do you talk to friends or people about this and get their impressions of how they're feeling and how they're dealing with it?
Yeah, I called a nurse I know last night to get her up, thinking she could calm me down a little. And she didn't have anything positive to say. She thinks it's going to get worse. So.
Yeah, this is one of those things where, usually something like this happens and they go, oh, well, don't worry about it. Things will get better soon and blah, blah, blah. And you don't hear that from anybody. You don't hear that from, the president for a while there was saying, don't worry, this is just the bad flu, you know. Our mayor, our governor, Mario Cuomo, who's very good when he speaks and very it's not that he's reassuring. You believe him in everything that he says, you know. And he does try to do a little calming down by saying, you know, the worst thing is panic. For instance, I don't understand the hoarding of toilet paper.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the last thing I'm going to think about is wiping my butt. Okay? I mean, if worse comes to worse, I can go to the bathroom and then hit the shower, right? You know, if need be. I mean, toilet paper? Come on. You know? And they're hoarding all kinds of other stuff, canned foods and things like that. And what they think is this, it's like they're getting ready for the apocalypse, and it isn't the apocalypse yet. And even,
not yet.
Even if it were, the amount of cans you bought are not going to get you through the apocalypse. Okay? So,
I was in Safeway yesterday. I go down there, there's a line, so they're letting people in. When someone leaves, they let another person in, and the shelves are pretty much cleared. There's
really?
No paper, no bread, no meat, just, oddly enough, a lot of frozen pizzas.
A lot of frozen pizzas?
Yeah, those are still there.
Don't people know you can wipe your butt with them? I've a local place, supermarket, and it didn't seem to have that same problem. It seemed crowded, but it didn't seem to have that same problem.
Sounds like things are better in New York than they are here.
However, I haven't been to Costco. You see, I mean, part of the reason why I don't go certain places is I'm 80 years old, and I just had prostate seeds implanted in me, and I probably have a compromised immune system, I would imagine. And I'm not taking chances, right? And neither is Marjorie. We're being very safe about it. I go down to the store. I'm taking my mask with me, you know.
Good.
I'm taking gloves. Just because, you know, if I were 15 or 20 or 25, I wouldn't be worried about it that way. I'd go, okay, if I get it, I'll have the flu for a couple of days and it'll be over with. But it's killing people my age. And if it gets bad enough, and here's what I heard, here's the problem. Okay, so we don't have enough respirators, right? And you've only got one respirator available, right? Now you've got me, the 80-year-old, with coming back from prostate cancer, okay? Or you've got a 40-year-old who's got the rest of his life ahead of him. Who are you going to give ventilator to? Right?
Yeah.
You know, so I'm a dead man either way if I get this thing. So, you know, the only thing I've had in the last couple of days, we've had allergies here in New York, and that's about that. That's not fun in and of itself, but not the...
Yeah, because you probably think you're getting the first...
Well, the one thing, if you don't have a high temperature, you don't have it. Okay? That's it. Plain and simple.
Is that the first sign of temperature?
Yeah, yeah. And it's good if you got your flu shot, because if you got your flu shot and you come down with the flu, then you know you probably got it.
Yeah. Ooh.
So,
I never get the flu shot. So.
Yeah. So, I mean, you could just come down with a normal flu, seasonal flu. And on top of that, our government's doing nothing. I mean, you know, our president today was talking about certain pills they found that might help that are already out there and blah, 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 blah. All of this is pure speculation, you know. But what we really need is leadership. And here in New York with Cuomo, we've got great leadership. He's done a great job of handling the situation in a well thought out manner. You know.
Well, he doesn't want to quarantine everyone.
No, he doesn't want to do the quarantine because he doesn't see that it will accomplish anything. You know that other things they do, like closing the restaurants and so on, he felt was a very good move. Because any place where people congregate in close quarters should be done away with. It's amazing what's happened here. It's like a ghost town out there. You know, they call New York the city that never sleeps. Well, I'm sorry to tell you, it's snoring, okay? Because there's nothing going on. You can't go to a restaurant. You can't go to the theater. You can't. A lot of people have been hitting the parks because they've been encouraged to go out into the parks and get outdoors. That there's nothing wrong with taking a walk, okay, as long as you stay 6 feet away from other people, which is easier when you're outside than when you're in a theater or someplace like that. So, you know, you know, like you, you're still running, right? I imagine.
Yeah, I'm going to run today. So.
And are there a lot of other people out there running?
There were a few, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But they don't prevent you from doing that. They don't mind you going out and getting exercise as long as you...
Not yet, but I think they're getting close. I think they're up in Seattle now. You're not allowed to go out and do that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's because, you see, outdoors would seem to be a little safer just because it's fresh air.
Yeah.
If you don't get within 6 feet of somebody, it is transmitted by people sneezing and by spittle and so on and so forth. Oh, what was that lovely tone that my computer just decided to make? So, you know, I mean, who knows where all this is going to end? But so you're depressed about it.
Yes, I don't want to be locked up. On the other hand, I guess the spring break in Florida, the young kids are just running crazy. It's like everything's okay.
Well, Cuomo was talking about that today, saying they're really being stupid and foolish.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
they are.
That you have to be considerate of other people, and if you come down with it, no, you're not going to die from it. You got the stamina to survive it. But then you go home and you see grandma and you give it to her and she dies.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So have consideration for other people, you know. He said, this is absolutely crazy. You would rather party and not be considerate of other people. It's a question of just because you're young doesn't mean you can't give it to somebody. And that's the problem. So, you know, but what's really nuts is what's Florida doing about it? We're closing the beaches on Monday. Well, spring break is over on Monday.
Yeah, in fact, good timing.
The way it's going now, isn't spring break forever now? I mean, there are no schools open. Colleges are not going to reopen after spring break.
Everything's closed.
Yeah. Just amazing. But it's amazing that Florida didn't say, get off our goddamn beaches now.
Yeah.
You know? So, I don't know. So, what are you doing to keep yourself occupied indoors?
Well, when you got no cable and no high-speed internet, there's not a lot to do.
Yeah, I was thinking about you with that, you know? If you were working at a company, but you were the same Larry Bubbles Brown, okay, and they said, okay, everybody work from home, you'd be dead in the water.
I couldn't work. Well, this may be the time to sign up for high speed, I think.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, Marjorie's doing all her work from home. She's not going into her office. And we're ready to kill each other.
You've got 2,500 square feet. That's bigger than a house.
Yeah, we've got the room that if I don't want to see her for the rest of the day, I can somehow put enough space between myself and her to not do it. So we're not climbing in on each other. You know, and we of course we have every cable channel you can have, and I have movies, and I have all kinds of things, and you know. So it's not like we're isolated from the world, but in your case, you've got a studio apartment, no high-speed internet, and what amounts to a flip phone.
Yeah.
So you're really isolated. I mean, you don't have Netflix, right?
No.
So you could be watching endless movies. Oh, and what's happened about the release date of your album, or did it finally come out?
It came out a couple of weeks ago, yeah.
Yeah. How's it doing?
I haven't heard. They're supposed to send me some stuff, but I can't decipher this. But
yeah.
Well,
I would say to people who are listening,
people be forced to listen since they have nothing else to do now.
You people have nothing else to do. You should buy his album. Where can they go find it? Where can they buy it?
That I don't know.
Wait a minute. You don't know where they can, but can they go on Amazon and buy it?
I think it's on all the guy that handles this, they put it on all those internet streaming things, and I think you can actually get a CD if you want. And
Yeah. I have to look it up after the show and see if it's on Amazon. But you know, buy it because it'll give you at least something to do for 45 minutes.
Yes.
Right.
But then what if this thing goes on for months? People are going to go insane.
Well, you'll just have to do another album. Oh, wait a minute. There's no club for you to do it in.
You can write a new album every day.
Huh? Yeah, but I mean, the point is you can't have an audience for it, right?
No.
Could you do your act without an audience?
I don't think so.
Oh, boy. Oh, my. We should do some night. You know, I have this thing called the Citizen Panel where I have a whole bunch of people on at the same time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we should call you some night when I have a bunch of those people, and then you can do some of your act, and they can all laugh at it. So you'll have an audience.
Or not.
Huh? Yeah, or not.
God.
Yeah, well. What can you say, you know?
I was reading about the Spanish flu that hit 100 years ago, which was, I'm surprised a movie hasn't been done about that, but they think that might have killed 100 million people.
Well, it's estimated between 50 and 100 million.
And the population of the world was a fourth of what it is now, so it was...
Yeah. So, I mean, it thinned out the population considerably. But then again, we didn't have antibiotics. We didn't have a lot of the things. We didn't have ventilators. You know, we didn't have a lot of things that we have today. And deaths from that flu, given today's science and so on and so forth, might not have been as devastating.
Okay, they said that thing kept mutating and getting worse and worse, and then suddenly it just disappeared overnight.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember why they called it the Spanish flu, because it didn't start in Spain. It started actually at an army base in the United States, from what I understand.
In Kansas, yeah. They thought it was Spain, but it was actually in Kansas.
Yeah. And everybody was then going over to the war in Europe, and that's where it spread to Europe.
Yeah.
And actually, it was such a devastating plague that the war was halted for about 6 months, something like that?
That's bad when you can stop a war.
you have to stop a war due to a deadly disease. Oh, boy. Well, what the hell? Let's not depress everybody.
Well, at least we're not talking about our medical maladies today.
Yeah. How are your maladies doing?
This is you don't want to get something else wrong with you now, because you can't get to a hospital unless you've got the flu.
Right.
Or
right.
The virus.
Well, I've got, my hernia is bothering me a little bit today. Yours is always bothering you.
Yeah. So.
You know, I don't think I need to have it operated on yet, but, you know, they don't just suddenly decide to cut these days on those things, do they? They wait till they see that they might be a problem.
They want you to, they don't want to do the surgery, really.
Yeah. So, you know, and then I have to go in for a CT scan for my prostate seeds that I had, that they do a month later to see that they're all working properly. And, you know, it's not diagnostic. It's just for the records. And I have to have a CT scan. I wonder if they're going to do my CT scan, or whether they're going to tell me, wait, we can do it later. You know?
I bet they're going to say, wait.
You know. And I have a court case, which I think is not going to happen, you know, because the courts are kind of limited. The only essential trials, I guess, things like that. So, well, it's the, as I call it, the new normal, you know, and it's like some horrible science fiction movie. And if this never goes away, it'd be interesting to see what the world's like in a year from now. Yeah.
Oh, that'll be amazing.
Well, things will start falling apart because there are no repairs going on, you know, things like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, good talking to you again, Larry, on these happy circumstances.
Very upbeat topic today.
And we're running this one day and date with when we do it because it is so of the moment. And there is one that I didn't run of yours, which I'll run next week, which I don't even know. It's pre-flu, so I don't know what.
Well, let's hope.
You know, I may just wind up calling you next week if I can't use it, but...
Okay.
You know, stay safe and
bless you. Stay healthy, man. I'm very worried about us.
Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Bubbles Doomsday Brown.
Brown.
5 years and still talking. This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Yes, Larry. Thank you, Larry. Appreciate it. Actually, we recorded two interviews with Larry, one of which I was going to run this week, and then I decided that we were going to do a thing with him, and we decided to do it anyway because he's out in California. That's one of the other ground zeros for this this little plague that we have going on here. So next week, if I run one, it'll probably be way out of date, and we won't be talking about the flu or anything else. Okay. All right. Okay. Listen, our lines are now open. Put those active. Okay. And I think we're ready to go. We're just waiting for somebody to start calling. And who will be the first one up tonight? That's the question. Let me see here. Anything I want to tell you? Oh yeah, I got a thing from YouTube about my monetization question, and they said you're absolutely right, and they demonetized the other one, the secondary one. I don't get it. Anyway, I'll talk to you about that a little bit later. But first, we got Sibby Itty, who is, you know, what's nice about this whole problem that we're having. Let me see here. I got to get, hold on a second. I got to put these people in here. Here comes Charlie Wallace, too. Just everybody slow down a little bit. Let me catch up. There's Sibby Itty. Okay. And here comes Patrick Blazik. Hold on a second. Boy, you people are just coming at me fast and furious. Let me see here. Let me see here. Who have I got up there? Sibby, I got Charlie Wallace. And now we'll put in Patrick. And then let me see here. Oh, that's Patrick. Wait a minute.
What about Deb?
Sibby Itty, wait a minute. Hold on a second. I got... how did I get Patrick in there? Okay, now we go to three, and we go to Charlie Wallace, who I'm going to have to put in that spot. And, you know, these things are just starting to happen. There we go, folks. See, this is what's happening. And now I need to go to another thing here and put in number four. I need to put Mr. Zeller in there, and he's there, and that's okay. All right. Okay. Wait a minute. Hold on. Let me just get rid of that. And okay, we'll just do it this way. Okay. There you go, guys. How are you? Oh, wait a minute. Here comes Phil Meyer. Phil's late to the party. There he is. Okay, now let me see. Let me go to here, and let me go to the fourth spot and put him in there. These are all things I have to do, folks, in order to get people into their places. Scuba diver, there we go. And there is, oh, I just got to go boom, and then boom, boom, and there's Phil. Okay, all right. Hello, everybody. How are you? Man, you all gangbang me at the same time. That's exhausting. Usually you call one at a time, and we get to you, and it's, you know, it's doing okay. Anyway, hello, hello, hello. Hello, Mr. Zeller. How are you?
I'm good.
He's the other old fart beside me on the panel. He's 72, is it?
I'm 75.
You're 75. Oh, wow. Okay. Well, now I feel better about how old I am. These are a bunch of old farts here. I mean, most of you are all over the age of 60, except for Patrick, who is 97. Patrick is, how old are you again? You're in your 40s, right? You're 40, something like that?
44.
And he's healthier than the rest of us. Just about, you know. There are things that have gone wrong, okay? But basically, you're healthy, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, if it were a choice between that one ventilator and it was a choice between you or me, they would be choosing you for the ventilator, right? So, I'd probably have to do something about killing you so that I could get the ventilator.
Isn't it good to know that Ford, GM are going to be, and Tesla are going to be building ventilators for the government?
Well, we think so.
Yeah, I think it's good.
We think so.
It was a wartime act that Trump enacted. Today.
Yeah, the question is, how fast can they get going on that since they're not revved up to do those things? You know, it's not like they're going to rebuild a carburetor, okay?
They're not selling too many cars. So
yeah, this is not an unsophisticated piece of equipment. And how do they suddenly start producing these things? They've got to train people how to build them. They've got to learn how to test them. They've got to learn how to make them work. I mean, it sounds like an easy thing because Trump just goes, oh, well, we're going to do that and that will solve the problem. But it doesn't.
Robot.
Huh?
And Yang predicted it. The robots will build the ventilators so that the people could be restored to life and end up on welfare, you know. And the robots will build everything and we'll get $1,000 a month from Andrew Yang.
Wow. Well, you know, so I don't know how fast that can be ramped up. The only good piece of news, there was word that some company might have come up with a way to solve the virus. But the problem, well, hold on a second, Phil. Let me finish my thought before you jump in with something. But the question here is, and it's a big question, is, let me see here. Where's Rob? Oh, wait a minute. Oh, I thought I put him up. I haven't put him in there yet. Okay, hold on a second. Hold on, folks. I'm having to do 8 billion things at once, and I can't rub my stomach and do... hold on here. Where are we? There. Here comes. Where is it? Rob Alfano. There he is. Okay. And then we got Kevin calling in. So we got to go to the 8-pack, which will then let's see here. Put. Let me get rid of that. All right. Okay. And we'll put. I think what we'll do is we'll put Kevin. In there. Here we go. Hog Rider. There we go. Okay. So are we? Do we have that? There we go. Look at that, folks. Okay. We only need to fill that one little gap over there. Where were we? Okay. So we were talking about ramping up. The president was talking a lot of things out of his ass. You know, here's this thing. We're going to do that. We're going to get the car companies to start making the ventilators. I'm sorry, you can't ramp up that fast. Okay.
You were talking about...
Let me finish. Let me...
Well, you went off on another subject. I was just giving you back where you were.
Where was I?
You were talking about meds being developed for coronavirus.
Oh, yeah. He talked about one that's being worked on, but, you know, it hasn't been tested. They could give a shot to somebody of the thing and kill them, you know. That's always a possibility. The only thing that was promising, that was even mentioned, is a thing for that they developed for what was it? Ebola. And that that it may be the answer. It's found in some uses that it can combat this particular virus. So that seems that's something that's already in place. They have lots and lots of that stuff. Okay, so that's a possibility, you know. But it isn't as though the president brought us to it. All these people have been saying, here is our idea, here's this idea, here's that idea. And, you know, I think he's still doing a fucked up job between you and me. How about you, Kevin? You seem to be agreeing with that.
Yeah, he pretty much went back into Trump mode today, I think, during his press conference. He went back into his... defensive mode, started picking on the press again, and I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
He went on a presidential run there for a couple of days, and then he went back to his old self.
Yeah, yeah. And hello there, Rob.
Hello.
How
are you? Hear me okay?
Oh, you're sounding great. Yeah. It's great to see you back in a studio again. That's where you belong.
I wasn't listening, but did you guys hear that the Governor Nuisance put the whole state on.
Yeah, I was going to mention
shelter in place now.
No, it isn't even shelter in place. It's quarantine, isn't it? It's even worse than shelter in place.
Well, it's shelter in place, but it's basically people call it lockdown. People call it this, but it's shelter in place.
It's basically don't leave your house.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah,
I mean, you could go to the stores, and
we've been doing that already. So it's the same thing. It's just. They're trying to crack down on it. He also said that 56% of California was going to get infected too.
Yeah.
They're saying
that's over
in the next 8 weeks.
It's over 20 million people.
Yeah,
that's a lot of people.
Oh boy. Well, it's going to get worse before it gets better. That's all there is to it. I guess the big question is here. I mean, it's the big question that should be asked is, are we all going to survive? You know, and
not all of us.
Probably not all of us. I hope that we're all. I hope this crowd will be okay. All right.
I'm wilderness man.
Huh?
I'm in the wilderness here.
Yeah. Can I come join you? I won't bring it with me. Just if you got a room, I was thinking that the only guy who really had the right idea and would be safe from the coronavirus today would be the Unabomber.
Yeah.
What's going on, yeah.
He went up there into the mountains, and he had that little cabin, and everybody could be dying around him from this plague, and he could walk out into this wilderness with nothing, you know. Something like the last man on Earth. But it's frightening me. It's scaring me. It's scaring me so much, I won't even walk out the front door.
That's how I feel when I go into the supermarket. I run in and I leave. Mm-hmm. It's like I just want to get my shit and get out of here.
I'm getting to the point where I can't even do that. And I shouldn't be that way because Cuomo's been wonderful. I mean, he has just been... Hey, if he ran for president tomorrow, I'd vote for him, wouldn't you, Rob?
I like him.
The way he's been acting?
My brother said that to me today, and he hasn't been a big Cuomo supporter up until now.
Neither have I.
It's been so calming and so, together, and he makes you feel like he has a handle on this and that he's going to handle it. And that's what you want from a leader.
Well, no, he tells you when he doesn't have a handle on it, too. He's very honest about the whole situation. And it's done with a certain frankness and honesty that, quite frankly, I have to say is, at this point, quite refreshing. So I'm amazed by it. He doesn't say, there's no problem. He doesn't say, calm down, don't worry about it, blah, blah, blah. No, that's not what he's saying at all. He says, here are the facts. we're going to need these many hospital beds. We're going to need this. We're going to need that. Here's where the crisis is. Now, as for the rest of your lives, hey, you know, you can go to the park. You know, you can take a walk in the park. Just don't get within 6 feet of somebody. You know, you can kind of have a certain kind of normalcy. If you jog, go jogging. As long as you're not within 6 feet of somebody else, you know. So he has also been talking about normalcy as well. And I think that he has been so, I hate to use the word presidential in his approach. You know, he reminds me, I'll tell you, I had a lot of respect for Rudy Giuliani at one time. No, not because he got the seeds for his prostate and we're brothers, but that the way he handled 9/11, I thought was a textbook on how to handle a crisis like that. All right? So I give him much credit for that. He has since blown all that credibility, but at that time, he had that credibility. That's the same kind of thing that has been brought to the table by Cuomo. By Andrew Cuomo. And I wish our president would learn from it. I wish our president would say, let me look and see how Rudy handled his crisis, how Cuomo's handling the crisis, and try to be somewhat that way. But I don't think he has it in him. I don't think he has it in his inner core to do that. Yeah.
I think every day he proves himself to be less of a president.
Mm-hmm. How do you think this is going to affect his chances to get reelected? I mean, I hate to bring that up at this point because that's maybe the least important thing we could be talking about.
We've got to be able to get to the polls. We have to be able to get to the polls.
Yeah.
You know, when it's time.
Which leads me to ask the ultimate question, which is, and I hate to bring this up, but it's a good question. What is going to happen with the election? Do you think that this president will say, well, it can't be held because we've got this crisis going on? Yes, Phil.
We didn't hear you.
Yes, Phil.
Full house.
I know. I haven't gone to that yet. There we go. And there is the full house. Wait a minute. Hold on a second. Wait a minute. Somebody's got to be in the... Oh, is it... Somebody has to be in the 10th place?
Is my camera...
Yeah, Ray doesn't have his camera on or something.
I don't know why.
Oh, Ray doesn't have his camera on?
No, I don't know why. It should be on. It's weird.
Here we go.
Well, no, his we just get his picture. He doesn't have his camera.
I don't know. I have it on. Yeah, sorry.
It's Trump screwing stuff up for you guys.
Problem.
Let me see here.
It's not that sophisticated.
Let me see here. Oh, I know what the problem might be. It might be me here. Well, no, we don't have your picture. All we have is the Skype logo. So why don't you hang up and call back in again? Ray, can you hear us? What's happened to Ray?
Yeah, he left.
He left? Oh, okay. Well, anyway, that's his spot there, folks. Right up there. Okay.
There's two Kevins.
Hmm?
Somebody pointed out there's two Kevins on the
There's two YouTube. Kevins? Oh, what? How did that happen? Wait a minute. Then who's supposed to be in there? Oh, boy. Yeah, there are two Kevins, but who was in there? I don't know. I don't know. I have no idea who's not in there.
Probably where Ray was going.
Ray's not the one that's not in there.
Oh, Ray is not the one that's in there. Right.
Have an extra Kevin.
No, we have a Kevin, extra Kevin up there. Why do we have an extra Kevin there? Well, let me see.
So we actually have 11 spots.
We have... Wait a minute, cancel. Hold on a second. We want to go here. There we go.
One of me is bad enough.
There goes. There's Ray Renati. Okay, now let's see here. All right, there's Ray. Now hold on a second, everybody. First, I got to get rid of. Where is it? It's number 9. Okay, there we go. All right. And there's Ray. Okay. All right.
Hello.
Yeah. Okay. Let's now that we're through with these technical glitches, any thoughts about, you know, how this is going to affect his re-election at this point?
I think it's going to hurt him. I think he's done, really, you know.
Well,
I think Fox News right now is their job one, because they had to give up on the whole Democratic, you know, it was the left, you know, setting this whole thing up. Their job one right now is to make it look like it's anybody but Trump's fault. I was watching one of the shows today, and I watched a video of it today. I don't know if it was today or yesterday, but they were talking about how it's China's fault, and how they are, you know, we need to go after, when this is all said and done, we need to go after China on this and get reparations, because they let New Year's Eve happen in Wu-Tang, or whatever the hell the name of the place is where it came from. It's, you're shaking your head, but just a month ago, just 2 weeks ago, the president was laughing off this.
Yeah.
So why would it be any different, Phil? Why would it be any different?
It was
December. This thing just started.
That what he was trying to do was keep confidence in the people and downplay it a little so that people didn't panic. You know, that's what a president is supposed to do.
No, he's supposed to tell us the truth about what we need to do.
Exactly.
He wasn't being told the truth from China.
I heard the scientists standing right behind him saying things, and he was cutting them off and not letting them tell the truth. Yep. I heard it myself. I saw it. Can't bullshit like that. Well, unless you want to, of course.
So if Fox is going to blame China because they didn't react, well, neither did the U.S. government react.
Well, yes, they did, because within 10 days of the first of the Wuhan virus, Trump put in a travel ban, and that helped. You know,
Phil, let's be honest, why he put in the travel ban. It's because he always wanted to get at China in one way or another. That was the only reason he did it. If it were England, where he's got golf courses, he would have, or Scotland, he would have waited forever.
He banned them too.
After he was criticized for not doing it. Yes,
you know,
Sibby.
They spent Sibby, 13 hours in the transition period. They spent 13 hours talking about, with Flynn, I believe it was, about a pandemic, impossible pandemic, during the transition of Trump, from Obama to Trump. That they talked about this possibly happening, and that they just kind of shoved it under the rug and then disassembled that part of the CDC.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sibby, you have
They spent 13 hours talking about this could happen back in 2017, I believe it was, or 16, whenever they transitioned.
Yeah.
And that's Obama's fault.
Trump did not become a woman. Okay, so let's remember that.
Yeah, he just kind of shoved it under the rug and said, and moved on.
Yeah.
Sibby,
you had your hand up.
Yeah. See, this is all about numbers. I think Trump has 33 to 35% of the votes locked in. So he has to fight for the next 15 or 16% to win this election. Think of it like this. What he has started doing is he had already announced that he is the wartime president. This is war. And Americans, you know, have this psyche that they don't want to change when it's war.
He's doing a Bush.
That's the first thing. Second thing, what he's going to do is he's going to make the most hay out of it. He's going to start some manufacturing over here, and he's going to say, we're going to take everything back from China and start making things here. Third thing, he is going to do that freebie. What Obama didn't do in 2009, Trump is going to do it. He's going to send the money straight to people. And Larry Kudlow already said that if you're bailing out the companies, we're going to have stake in the companies. This is exactly what liberals wanted Obama to do in 2009, which he never did. So everything that liberals wanted Obama to do for them, Trump is slowly doing it. But he's going to do it for the next 8-9 months, whatever is left. He's going to go full throttle, full liberal. The Bernie Sanders liberal, the free cash, free money. He's going to, in fact, he's going to also act like Spain, probably nationalize one or two hospitals. Think of it like that. He could do it. He could absolutely do it. And all these people are going to fall in line. And remember, Alex, it's only 15% he wants. He has a 35% locked in. Like Phil, you know, Phil and, you know, his, you know, he's part of the 35%. So all Trump has to do is fight for that 15% and he's going to have it.
Well, he could.
That's
he
how
could,
I think.
He could, Sibby, he could lose a certain part of that percentage that he already has to a guy like Joe Biden, who knows how to play the middle class, okay, and knows how to play the working man. So he does have a pretty good foe when it comes to Joe Biden in that respect. You know, I mean, Joe is liked by the working guy, by the labor guy. And those are some of the people who voted for Trump before. And 15% is a lot to get, you know.
It is, but think of it like this. Hunter Biden could be Hillary's email from 2016 for 2020.
Yeah.
Trump is going to dig it up. He's going to have Justice Department go all okay. after this guy.
But let me go back.
And have him subpoenaed. You know, these are things which he could play dirty. You know,
okay, Obama but never am played I being... dirty.
Obama had the chance to dig up all his crap, his tax, all his money, his investment in the 8-9 months that he had. He never did it because he played clean. Trump is not going to play clean.
Yeah.
He's
let
going
me ask
to go
you
really
this.
Dirty on Biden.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. The question was brought up. The election's coming up. Undoubtedly, we could be in the worst part of this virus, or we could be on the better side of this virus. We don't know. We have no idea. But let's say we're on the still on this bad side of this virus. Could this president say, I'm calling off the elections for now since people can't get to the polling places and all of that? Or does he have to hold it come hell or high water?
He has no power.
There is nothing in the Constitution that gives him that power. Nothing.
Right. Yeah. Phil?
And I think
the elections must happen.
Yeah.
The Constitution says the elections must happen.
There is some clause in the Constitution somewhere. I'm trying to remember it because, you know, I read it when I was applying for the
Even in 1918, the elections happen.
Phil has his hand up. And then Kevin, right. And then.
I got something.
What Joe Biden has done by picking Klobuchar as his VP is possibly secure a vital state.
When did he nominate Klobuchar for his VP?
Yes, he said he was picking a woman, and today I read he made a deal with Klobuchar.
You read somewhere. I haven't read or heard anything like that. All I heard was he said that he's planning on getting a female.
You haven't read a lot of things, but... I read that he's picking Klobuchar as.
Where'd you read that?
I don't know. I read all day. So
All I'm saying is I heard him say he was gonna offer it to a woman, but he didn't say he was going for Klobuchar. That was some kind of what's the word I'm want to use here? Some kind of people thinking out of the box, trying to figure out who he was going to pick. He could very easily. Kamala Harris. Hold on a second, Phil. No. Kamala Harris would be a very good candidate because she's also black.
He'll win California regardless, and the blacks already like Biden. So the thing is, Klobuchar's state is going to be vital, and I don't think Trump can win if Klobuchar's...
Did Klobuchar win her state?
Yeah.
In the primaries?
No. Klobuchar pulled out, I think, before then.
Yeah, she pulled out.
Okay. So, but that's one state that I think is necessary for Trump's path to success. So I think Biden, by picking Klobuchar, is going to be a very good move for him.
Well, I don't know he's necessarily going to pick Klobuchar. You know.
I just Googled the Biden picks running mate, and nothing comes up for any. It just says he's looking at, he says he's going to pick women, top 12 running mate possible, you know, that kind of thing. There's no headline that says he picked anybody.
It may not be a headline. I don't remember where I read it, but I did read it. And the bottom line is it's a good strategy.
Just because you read it doesn't mean it has any credibility.
Line is it hasn't happened.
And then a state that is going to win anyway.
Kevin's had his hand up here. Yes, Kevin.
Gabbard for vice president. But anyway.
too hot. Joe would be sniffing her hair, rubbing her shoulders.
If they were going to have an election in November and they decide, couldn't they, knowing what we know today, why couldn't they put everything into a mail ballot or something like that? They could put everything into a mail. They'd know enough ahead of time.
That would take forever to count.
How about it would take forever to count, but it would be an election.
They better start now.
They could count it.
Yeah.
They could count it.
They could count it by January 20th. That's all they have to do.
It takes, I work the county elections, and it takes us 5 days to count.
Ray?
The county elections. 5, 6, 7 days, maybe.
Ray?
So
see what Phil saw. So Klobuchar was talking to a group of people, a crowd, and she said, "I could not think of a better way to end my candidacy, as hard as it was to do with our beloved staff and everyone else, than to join the tick." And then she stopped herself because she almost said ticket. But she said that what she meant to say was terrific. So
would you like a Tic Tac?
Yeah. Or do you go on TikTok?
Right. Sure.
It's coming, and her state is crucial to Biden winning. Mm-hmm. There it is. And you can say, Hawaii is not going to carry the election, and it's not going to be a pivotal state. California's already hit.
I don't remember Minnesota ever going for a Republican.
It went for Trump, didn't it?
I don't remember.
Yeah, I think Minnesota went for Trump.
Yeah, Minnesota usually is a very Democratic state.
And it was a very small percentage. Klobuchar could make a major difference.
Yeah, but Minnesota isn't a major state, a must-win state. Okay.
I believe it's only 10 electoral votes.
Yeah, it's not a must-win state. The must-win state, and the state that if you didn't win it, if you don't win there, you don't win because it hasn't happened in, 50, 60 years, something like that, is Ohio.
Yeah.
That's the state you got to win.
But at that Tim Kaine, is it, that he would pick from there, is a man, and if he said that he was going to pick a woman, it doesn't make sense that he would pick him.
Well, he would pick somebody from the area, I suppose, who would appeal to that mentality.
That's why I said Tim Kaine, but Tim Kaine is a woman. Yeah. He just dresses like a man.
But do you think Trump's in trouble, though?
No, I think that he's lost 10 to 15 points recently, but there's a long time between now and November, and also a lot of things can happen between now and then.
There are a lot of possible deaths between now and then, too.
Probably a little bit bad.
I don't think so.
You know, this is a guy.
You're right, Phil.
Let's look at one other fact. Okay, here's a guy who says, the economy's gotten better while I've been president. Well, I got news for you. It's right back where it was before you became president.
If we get 20% unemployment because of this?
Nope, nobody's blaming him for this.
Oh, really? Oh, really? Every time he opened his mouth and said something wrong, the stock market the other day, after giving one of his speeches, before his speech, it was something like it was down 1,000 points. Okay. Right a minute. Let me finish. Right after the speech, it went down 3,000 points.
Yeah.
So tell me he doesn't have anything to do with it?
There's no confidence coming from him.
If he were presenting more confidence, that stock market wouldn't be tanking like it is.
I hate when he wheels himself out there.
And now you want a really paranoid idea? I wonder if his family's buying shorting the stock once it goes. Once he know they know it's going to go down.
He fluctuated.
Nothing
so
would shock me.
You keep saying he doesn't have any money. How can he invest
it? Well, he doesn't have any money. That's why he might do a play like this. He knows that when he says something like he says it, the stock goes down. So that's maybe the time.
I think you're forgetting who the real culprits are, and our culprits are China. And
the culprit is not China, Phil.
They're fighting a war against us. And
Charlie has his hand up. Yes, Charlie.
There was a Republican senator who I can't remember who it was now, but who 3 or 4 weeks ago was telling everybody everything you're going with the Trump line publicly, but was telling his private donors the things were going to be real, and he sold off like $1 million worth of his own stock while Trump was telling everybody how everything was fine.
I think it was the guy from Intel or IBM, one of those. I think Intel.
He was an inside trader. They're going to go after him for. He's on some committee, and he may end up getting thrown out of the, being prosecuted.
Republican senator. I want to say it's Inhofe, but I don't think it was Inhofe. I think it was a different Republican senator. It was an actual Republican senator who was doing it.
He was the head of whatever, some committee that, and they didn't say his name, but I saw his picture, and I saw him speaking on the news tonight. Maybe I just wasn't listening, but he's a high-ranking member, Republican member in the Senate, and he's in trouble.
Yeah,
what he did was he got out of certain stocks.
Yeah,
and got into other ones, and it was because they knew he had inside information.
Well, all I know is that
some of it was airline stocks. So they knew people weren't going to fly anywhere.
Yeah, I will blame Trump for the downturn in the stock market because of his very bad way of talking to the public and explaining where we are and where we're going and how we're going to solve the problem, because they don't have confidence in the president. Every time he opens his big fat mouth, the stock starts dumping. So don't say it isn't his fault, Phil. It's a direct result of things that he says.
I don't agree. I thought that his message.
Okay, let's just take a poll. How many people here, raise your hands if you agree with what I just said?
Kangaroo court.
Come on. Yeah. Obvious.
How about you, Patrick? Patrick's been very quiet.
It doesn't matter, Charlie. You'd vote for it anyway.
Patrick's the other Republican on this panel. Patrick, how do you feel about what I said?
I think it's a combination of Trump and the situation worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
I don't pin it to him. Like, everybody wants to just pile on him because they, just like everybody's accusing him of pointing the finger just at China, everybody's looking to point the finger just at him. Now, as the president, he does have some influence on the economy, but the economy worldwide is tanking. That had nothing to do with Trump. Every fucking market around the world is tanking.
Is it tanking as badly as it is here? Are the percentages the same?
It matters. The thing is...
Well, it does matter. I mean, if it's worse here than it is in, say, England, then it's because somehow Boris, whatever his name is being far more... handling the situation better. I mean, it really, the stock market is very skittish. It will start plummeting because it gets scared, okay? And there's a selling panic that happens. The president can prevent this by making sure he parses his words carefully and can minimize the damage. Granted, there was going to be a drop, okay? But... When you're talking about a fact that a few weeks ago we were up about, 29,000, Rob, do you remember? 29,000, and now we're down around 10,000 a point drop since this thing began, that's pretty severe, you know? Yes.
I got to kind of agree with what Patrick's saying, though. There's a lot of times when he talked that the stock market went up. Whether it was bullshit or not, it went up. You know, I still don't think that what he says necessarily influences the stock market. Mm-hmm. I can't believe that. I think it's just a lot of the sheep in the stock market themselves doing what they do, maybe because of what he's doing, but I don't think he influences it.
But his Secretary of the Treasury, what's his name?
Mnuchin,
who happens to be my eye doctor's brother-in-law. Yeah. And he says nobody in the family likes the guy.
He's a weirdo looking guy.
Yeah. He has said that we can perhaps expect, as this thing continues, if it continues like it is, a 20% unemployment rate.
Yep.
Now, when that happens, I don't care whether you say Trump is to blame or isn't to blame. The people who are part of that 20% are going to blame him.
That's right.
Okay. Well, he's in charge.
Because he's in charge. Yeah. He had never heard of the saying.
On his watch, but he won't take that blame.
Well, he has a sign on his desk that says the buck starts here. Oh, excuse
me. That's right.
What?
Here's the question. If you're going to take all...
No matter what, he's just the type of person that won't take that blame, and he won't accept it.
But it's very easy. It's very easy for a president to take the blame by simply saying, I'm president of the United States, and if something happens under my watch... You want to blame me, then I accept that blame.
He'll never do it. That's not.
But he, it's not. But any other good politician would do it.
That's right. That's right. But he's just not.
I mean,
that
when you say when the economy is tanking, and when this virus is spreading, and he's not at the rudder. You know, he's not at the. He's not running the steering the boat. You just can't say when somebody asks you out of 10, what score would you give yourself? And he says a 10.
But
come on.
Trump is the type of person
that
goes to take a shit and clogs up the toilet and walks out of the bathroom and says, I didn't do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty good answer.
And then leaves the thing to roll all over the floor.
Yeah.
There was a reason he said 10. Because if he would have said 8, then the counter would have been, well, what do you think you could have done better? They were setting him up with that question.
Well, then you say what you think you could have done better. I mean, I think if I said to Mario Cuomo, Mario Cuomo, what kind of a job do you think you're doing? He might say, doing a 5 or 6. I'd say, well, what are you doing wrong? And then he would give you a whole list of things he thinks he could do better. That's just an honest answer, Phil.
Doing it all.
No,
right.
You have a man who is incapable of admitting wrong.
The key word, honesty. He doesn't have it.
Yes, right. Yes, Ray.
That, you know,
I think he's leading.
Ray.
To some degree, I agree with Patrick. We don't know how much his influence on the market has been. He's had some influence on it, I think. Now, he goes against the whole idea of the buck stops here, that Harry Truman, you know, said years ago, and he says, I take no responsibility. I heard him say that.
Yeah,
and
sure. He actually used those words.
That does not instill confidence in the population. That, therefore, hurts the economy.
Do you remember when Trump was running for president in 2016 and he was sniffling and everybody thought that he was using cocaine? Well, he was actually bringing over the COVID-19 virus. he was going to infect all of you. Yeah. You know, that's why he was sniffling. So blame Trump. He brought the virus over here.
We haven't heard from Rob.
Too long of an incubation period. It didn't happen.
We haven't heard from Rob in a little bit. Rob, how do you feel about this? I mean, we have a term that's called being presidential, and I don't think he's being presidential at all. He's not inspiring confidence.
No.
He's had a few days, he's had a few moments of it recently, but that's been it in, what, 3 years
You
now?
Know what it's like, though? It's like his mother, who isn't alive any longer, but his mother said to him, listen, you're doing this all wrong. Next time, go out and apologize for this, or be nicer to your adults. Okay, and now he's being told that behind the scenes, you know, you're really blowing it, pal. And he goes out there and he tries to be good, and he's good for about 15 minutes, And then all of a sudden, it's like, you know.
Zing.
Yeah.
He's got to zing somebody.
Somebody the other day asked him, they said, you said, now is not the time for politics. And then for the next 3 days running, he ran tweets going against the Democrats. Why aren't you taking your own advice? He says, well, because they went after me. Mm. Well, it's not about you. It's about the country and about the country feeling not you don't have to sugarcoat this whole thing. You can say how bad it really is, but give them some confidence that you're doing everything you can to make this better. And I don't get that feeling, and I want to get that feeling. I get that feeling from Cuomo. Cuomo's not telling me that I'm going to live, you know. He's just saying we're going to try and keep you alive. You know?
This is not the time for someone to be bullshitting us. You know, we need to hear the truth now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hmm. Really do.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Let me see here. Anybody been quiet so that I can call on them? Well, Tony. Yeah. He's gone.
The wallpaper think?
What does the wallpaper think? Yeah, talk to the wallpaper.
The wallpaper's too busy.
He got the virus and fell
and
out.
I'll tell you, I feel real sorry for it. You know, he went out and he said, oh, and we've got to take care of the cruise ships and we've got to take care of the airlines. You know, screw them. You know, they got their big boy pants on. You know, if they can build those big giant behemoths that they float on the water and are like bacteria petri dishes, they certainly can take care of themselves. What I worry about are the perhaps 20, 30 million people that are out of work right now because there's no place to go to work because their restaurant closed down.
Restaurants.
Yeah.
No, he specifically said airlines and hotels. And
he said cruise ships as well.
He did say cruise ships. Yes, he did.
Airline. And he does own a lot of hotels.
Yeah. Airplanes, guys. He said airplanes.
Did he say airplanes? Isn't that an old term?
He did.
Yeah. let's take the airplane. We're going to go on the airplane.
No, just to help you guys out, he does own a lot of hotels. And he did.
No, he doesn't, Phil.
His name is
on a lot of hotels. He franchises the name out, but he only owns a few of them.
I saw a Forbes list of his properties and what his mortgages were, and he owns a number of hotels.
You just changed your tune, though. You said a lot. Now it's a number.
Well, a number could be a lot. You know,
boy, you're in many ways, Phil, you're worse than Trump when it comes to defending what you say. You know,
well, it's true. You know, think of what hotels he owns. What's the one in New York? The one on the park. You know, the very luxurious one.
Oh yeah, but that's not really a hotel anymore. It's like,
did he convert to? Okay.
I think there are some hotel rooms in there, but it's been redone.
There's one in Washington, D.C., which was a post office.
Yeah.
And that's a Trump hotel.
Is that the Plaza, the one in?
Yeah,
Plaza.
Word has it. He's trying to sell that. He's trying to get out of that.
Yeah, well, meanwhile, that's why he says they should help the hotels and they should help the airline.
I don't think he said the hotels, actually, Phil.
Yeah.
Did anybody hear hotels?
That would have been a little.
He did the boats, I think.
Definitely said the cruise ships. And by the way, Princess Lines today announced that they'd be willing to turn over their ships to be floating hospitals for the time being during the duration of this thing, which I have to take my hat off to them. I think that.
Yes.
There's too much glare, but you know, you really got to hand it to them for coming along with that. And,
well, they're just placating to Trump so they can rent the rooms to the government.
Yeah, probably. And of course, Trump is sending up this this hospital ship. And what they're saying, the thing you're doing with the hospital ship, is that's where they're going to put people who are just sick. Okay, so they can reserve the regular hospitals for the people with the coronavirus. That's what I heard.
No, I thought they wanted the people with the corona to die at home.
What?
They want people with the coronavirus not to go into the hospitals and just let them die at home.
No, dude.
Is that a joke? They
don't want them going into the hospitals, because if they do, they're going to infect the hospital workers and staff, mm-hmm. and they just want them to recuperate at home.
They want them to recuperate at home, but you said die at home.
Well, they will die at home.
Most people don't die.
They say 80% recover.
They don't want the people who have the coronavirus, who do not have it in a particularly lethal way,
right,
to come to the hospital, because they're taking up a bed and they're going to get better on their own. It's going to resolve itself. However, right. what they want are people there who do have the coronavirus, who need the kind of medicine that the hospital can provide, and ventilators and so on and so forth.
Your incubator, your ventilator is going to go to one of those guys.
I thought of something mean. Imagine if I got the corona, I'd visit all the family members I hate. Yeah, here, I'll have some of my juice. Yeah,
have a little piece of love from Tony.
You got a low immune system? I made this just for you.
A guy in Japan had the coronavirus. He just died yesterday or the day before, and he was trying to infect as many people as he could.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I've been told by the CDC, I just got this notification today, and it's important for this program, that after tonight I can only have 5 people on at a time. By the way, that joke comes courtesy of Albert, who said that to me tonight. He said, did you hear the CDC said you can't do the Ramble with more than 5 people at a time? Actually, what we'll do is we'll move these spaces further apart from each other.
There's a promo idea. The originator of social distancing, the Gabnet. Right.
Yes, we've been socially distant from the very beginning.
That's right. Yeah.
By the way, what was the name of that? I was trying to remember the name of that those butt wipes from last night. What's the name of it again?
Brought to you by Dude Wipes.
Dude Wipes.
Feel fresh and clean and get rid of the stank.
You know, I think I'm the record.
Ain't no stank with a dude wipe.
Yeah, that's right. I just remembered, though, I have, I think, several boxes of the wet wipes, so the boxes of the toilet paper wipes, wet ones, that I haven't opened them up, and I think I could use those if I run out of toilet paper.
Just take them down.
I'm saving them for the apocalypse.
I feel like I really have to go over to Costco eventually. And Marjorie says, I don't want to go over there. It'll kill us. We'll die from going to Costco.
Some stores will have you go in if you're 60 and older. You can go in between like 7 and 8 in the morning.
I don't want to get up that early.
I want to go in by myself.
My brother,
you know,
did that
worked real well. I went in for Lysol and I got dude wipes.
In my head. My operations manager went this morning or Saturday, the other morning, to Safeway and try to get in, because he's 71, and so there's a special door that said 60 and over. So he went to that door, and people were starting to yell at him because he doesn't look 71. They kept saying, you're not over 60, and people are yelling, you know, let me see your ID. He actually didn't want to fight with anybody, went to the back of the other line.
I was gonna go to ours this morning, and my wife said, "Why bother? Just wait for a couple of Tuesdays and Thursdays, and then you'll go. You can go the next one." And I said, "Okay, we don't need anything anyway." So.
Well, I'm thinking about it. And I'm going, you know, it all sounds like it's a good idea, but is it really? You know, I mean, do I want to be in there with a bunch of, say, 70, 80 year olds who are more subject to the disease than the general population? So I don't know what the answer to that is. You know,
I figured it's safer. They're probably cleaner because they've been hiding out.
Yeah, exactly.
They can be pretty aggressive when it comes to going for the toilet paper.
Ray, turn on your camera. I know you had a problem with it there.
I saw what happened. I don't know what's going on with this thing.
He had his hand up there for a second, and then all of a sudden he went.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, so it's my camera that's screwing up again.
Okay. Yeah.
Damn. Okay.
Yeah. Because all we get is that lousy Skype logo, and I'd rather not give them any more free publicity than it already does by having them down in each corner of every person that's on this panel.
Four people are watching.
Looking earlier tonight. We hit 50. Four, yeah. We hit 50 tonight.
Really? Yeah, right now you got 44.
45.
Well, okay. Well, maybe it'll change.
Yeah, it went up. Yeah. I, there we go. There's Ray.
Yeah, there's 45.
Yeah.
You've got a Trump, a 45.
You know, there's a website now that will calculate when you're going to run out of toilet paper. You put in, like, off when you go, how many squares you use, how many people in your house, and how much you have.
Does it say how many men, how many women?
Yeah.
Because women use toilet paper like they were eating it for lunch.
Mummify your hand. You know, some people, when they go to the bathroom, they wrap so much toilet paper around their hand, it's like a mummy, you know.
Well, here, the way I do it is I'll take like about three, you know, they always say 500 sheets. And you would think, hey, 500 sheets, how many times do I go to the bathroom? If I use one sheet every time I go to the bathroom, I'm going to have this toilet paper forever. But no, who uses one sheet? So you roll it over, and then I double it over, and I do what I do. Then I double that over and clean some more, and I double that over, you know, until it becomes unmanageable. That's the best way to save, you know.
Does it get smaller and smaller each time?
Each time, yeah, yeah.
So eventually, you're using your fingernail.
Eventually, yeah. What was the old joke about, I don't know, this is a piece of tissue paper, about, well, you do this, and then you do this, okay, and then you do this, and then you do this. And they go, well, why do you do that? They say, well, because when you're through, then you wipe the rest of it with your finger. Joke. Okay, well, anyway.
I've been using a hamster, and then you can just wipe it off.
Really? or a dude wipe. Or
I actually have a device that I invented that I was going to try and market, but I decided that it wouldn't go over. It connects to your shower head. And it's a tube with five holes in the end of it, and you're able to wash your bum with that.
Hey, Phil.
Sibby has his hand up.
That device is available in the Middle East. It's been in production for 50 years.
Yeah, you can. They tell kids to turn your toilet into a bidet.
It's like a small head, yes. It squirts. You press it and it squirts.
Right.
It's there.
It's like a bidet.
It's like a bidet, but it's a hand bidet.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a hand bidet.
Yeah. And they have them in the Philippines.
I built it myself.
Did you really?
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
You know what I saw is we could do it in our house, one of those French type of showers where you can undo it and move it around.
Mm-hmm.
You take it around and you duct tape it to the back of your toilet, and then you point it up, and then you just turn on the shower.
I just wish everybody would stop hoarding stuff. You know, this is not the apocalypse, for crying out loud. You know,
people got 10 years worth of toilet paper.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if I wanted to hoard it, I got enough room in this place to take. I mean, to begin with, what's a lifetime supply of toilet paper? You can buy as much toilet paper as you want to, and you're probably never going to run out, you know?
How long your life is.
Yeah.
Worse things, you know. There's worse things than running out of toilet paper.
Yeah, I just think that, you know, the public has got to, they've got to calm down on a certain level. I'm not going out because I feel that I am in a very, what could we call it, dangerous group. I do have a face mask, and I do have gloves that I can wear when I go out. And if I go to the store, I can wear the gloves so that I don't, you know. But then when you get home, you got to make sure you clean the face mask, okay? Mm-hmm. And you got to make sure that you clean the gloves, you know, because after all, it's not like some kind of magical thing where the...
If you clean the face mask, does it make it less... less effective?
No, it's not. It has no material on there, but the actual... Am I right, Kevin? You're nodding yes, right? Oh, your mic needs to be on, Kevin. It's not
you
on.
You need to clean the face mask. It's imperative.
How do you clean them?
Use a new one?
You also have to be very careful about not touching the front of it very much to use it correctly.
Right.
How do you clean them then?
Yeah, you're supposed to chuck them. They're disposable.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, not the big one. They're hard enough to find, so you don't chuck them. That's the reason you don't chuck them.
Well, you're supposed to, but they're hard to. They're telling people not to chuck them. Yeah, you're right.
Right.
But you'd have to blow them out and sanitize them.
Here's one other thing. Okay, a lot of you, because we all get our stuff by Amazon now, and probably I'm going to start ordering my food through Amazon. So Amazon delivers a box to you. Does that box have a virus on it?
You're supposed to spray it.
I'm thinking that. Should I start cleaning the box?
Oh, I put on a pair of rubber gloves, or I open it, and as soon as I open it, wash my hands.
Yeah.
I don't.
They say that the coronavirus can stay on a package, on a cardboard box, for 24 hours.
Yep.
The other day, that when I got this console delivered, the FedEx guy comes to the door, and it was signature, right? Because this is a $2,000 thing. He comes to the door. He hands me his computer, that handheld computer deal, and wants me to sign it. And I looked at him. I'm like, really?
Oh, my God.
Got to sign it. So I ran inside immediately and washed my hands. I'm like, touching his computer.
I have a small pen on my keychain, and what happened today was I went to get lunch from one of the local businesses, the to-go lunch, because I figured, hey, you got to support these people. And so I get the lunch, and she hands me the thing to sign for my debit card, and there's the pen, and I'm looking at the pen, and I'm saying, I'm not going to touch that. And I pull out my keychain, I pull off my own pen, and I sign the thing. And it's give like it back.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you can just tell her to sign it and scribble your name on there.
I don't think that was
they
her.
Don't check it. They just want a signature.
Yeah.
Anyway, I signed it, but I signed it with my own pen. It's
tomorrow night. I want to discuss what you think the future of schools are as a result of this. And what the future of movie theaters are.
We're going to find out soon.
Yeah.
I think that people are going to, after a while, get used to living their life in a different way. And I think that, for instance, like some school districts might just say, hey, you know, we were successful in teaching people online, right, from home. If we continue that, we don't have to have all these facilities. You know, and I think I was talking to Rob earlier tonight, and he said, well, what about sports? Things like sports and so on, they could still have those programs externally, you know. So,
you know, people, I think you're right. People are going to start telecommuting, and there's going to be less traffic on the road. I was on the road this morning.
A lot of businesses are going to say, why should I pay for a big
office
in an office building when we can do it this way? Yes, Kevin.
Here goes Trump's business.
One thing my daughter said to us at dinner last night, and it was pretty provocative because she's really into the environment and everything. Mm-hmm. She goes, well, one thing out of this, less carbon footprint right now.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, you're absolutely.
This is a 15-year-old.
Yeah.
They said the air was getting cleaner in China because everybody was off the streets and not producing anything.
Yeah,
so that kind of hit me weird, you know.
By the way, in where is it? The big town where it all started in China,
Wuhan.
There has not been a single case, I think, this week.
That's what the Chinese say. You going to believe them?
Yes, I will believe them now. Yes. No, before it wasn't a matter of believing them or not believing them. It's what they were telling us and not telling us.
Well,
now we don't have to worry about them. All we have to worry about is Trump. Anyway, that's it for tonight. Thank you, Sibby. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Charles. Thank you, Phil. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Kevin. And thank you, Ray, for making
it
a full house. Brought to you by Dude Wipes, the wipes of dudes or something like that. Anyway, all you guys, give a big wave goodbye, and I will wave back at you, okay? Yes, folks, Dude Wipes. Oh, boy. Oh, thank you, guys. I appreciate it. That's our citizen panel for tonight. Man, big one. And a lot of people listening to us tonight. What's happening? All of a sudden tonight, I think at one point, I didn't look, but I think we hit 50 people at one time. That means it could be several hundred over the course of the show. I'm overwhelmed. Anyway, we got to go. Next, over most of the same station, is The Intersection with Jack Bishop. I will be back again tomorrow night. Same time, same station in life. And in the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her. Bye-bye.